Okay, welcome to Gateway Bali. My name is Cliff. Welcome to our friends and visitors here, and also those who will be joining us by video. We're going to start with a corporate reading of the scripture, which is going to be up here, and you guys can read that, Galatians 5:1. So please join me as we do this together, just corporate. Galatians 5:1. 1, 2, 3. So Christ has truly set us free. Now make sure that you stay free and don't get tied up again in slavery to the law. These are by way some more announcements after that. Just to remind you that you can find more information on our online resources. Updates, information, and other things from the Facebook page and the YouTube channel there. And don't forget about the web page too. Secondly, please send us your prayer requests. If you have anything that needs prayer, send it to the WhatsApp to our Bali prayer line number so your family in Christ can support you in prayer before the Lord. Thirdly, this is for giving. Giving to the Lord and support for Gateway. You can give in the baskets at the doors as we leave today, or online through bank transfer. So there's the general fund for ministry. You have also opportunity to designate specifically for pastoral housing and for emergency relief fund. All right, so as we start this morning, let me lead us in some prayer as we start our service to worship. Let's bow our hearts, our minds. Father, heal our land, not just Bali, but throughout the world. And open our eyes to opportunities to share you with other people. Fill us with truth through your spirit as we worship now. Set us free to do that. And it's in his name we pray. Amen.
Okay, so we have a special guest here. You're all special. Trust me, you're all special. And you're not guests, you're all family. But we do have a visitor who has come back. And so I want to invite him up here, and he's going to share a little testimony with us. So please, Alex, come on up. Give Alex a hand. Stay right there. Right, you got to show off the muscles and the pectorals a little bit. So we have this camera. We're not worried about cameras. We're live. So, if you don't know, Alex's mom and dad are Grant and Sandy Weber, and they have been here. They were here before I got here, and they were part of Gateway in different ways, but doing lots of things in Bali to serve the Lord. And this is their oldest son, Alex. And Grant and Sandy dragged their family to Bali. And but here's a little story about what God has done. And so, Alex, tell us, one of your parents, when they were called, they felt called to come to Bali. One of their reservations in following that call was what?
Yeah. Is this not on?
Is this not on? Press the button.
There we go.
There you go.
Yeah. So, just to clarify, my parents did not drag our family here. When my parents first felt called to come and serve the Lord here in Bali, they decided that they would only do so if all six of the members of our family also felt that call. There's four of us kids, and my parents wanted it to be a family ministry, not just them dragging us along. And that's exactly what happened. It was incredible to see how God called every single one of us individually, one at a time, and then called us all as a family together here to Bali. But yeah, like you said, my dad did have some reservations. When we were in Canada, which is where we're from, if you didn't know, my brother Jonathan and I, we both played soccer at a very high level. And there was potential for us to do something with that. And my dad was very concerned about what would happen if we moved here and stopped playing soccer where we were playing. Long story short, that season, my brother and I were both cut from our teams. So it made it a very easy decision to move here to Bali.
So God helped the decision process along. But isn't that true of probably most of us, where we have a pulling of the Spirit of God to lead us, but there is fear of the unknown, fear of what if, you know, I've got this going on. Do I have to give that up to follow the voice of God? And I mean, that could be anything. In this case, it was this soccer. And every parent wants the best for their children. And if their children are being successful, and to cut that success off and say, hey, let's move. That's risky business, right?
Yeah. And I think I had no idea that the theme today was freedom. Wade just asked me to come and share. I think that fits really cool, really well. It's really cool the way God gives us freedom from things we need to be freed from, even when we might not necessarily want to be at times.
So when they left and they said, okay, forget soccer or football, whatever you call it, all right, we'll go, we'll follow the Lord, we'll come to Bali. And here they started FC Bali, which is a football club for neighborhood kids and to help with who they are and their character and leagues and stuff like that. And that's a great thing, but it doesn't advance you in your career any, right? It's a kingdom thing, but not necessarily as a personal success. So fast forward that, and why are you here now? How does this story kind of flip on its head?
Yeah, it's a very long story, so I'll try and give the short version. But yeah, at FC Bali, obviously, I wasn't playing. I was coaching, so that was not helping my career. But I was playing for a club down in Jimbaran, and while I was there, a player's agent saw me, and he kept asking me to sign with him so that he could get me to a team. And I said no. I said I'm going to college, because that's what I was planning to do. And then in early 2019, we went back to Canada on furlough, and I went to college to play soccer. And right before I went down, this guy called me. He said, hey, I have a team that wants you. Will you come play for us? I said, no, I'm going to college. And then fast forward to end of my first semester, I got back from break, and I was sick of school within the first week of being back to classes. And I thought, you know what? Let me give this guy a call. So I said, hey, do you have a spot for me? And he said, yeah, come as soon as you can. And I said, well, I'm going to finish out this year of school, but let me think about it. And when I said think about it, I meant talk to God about it and see if that's something that would work. So after probably 6 months of praying about it and talking to people about it and looking into the opportunity, I decided that I was going to accept a contract to play professional soccer in Timor-Leste. And I went to talk to my coach. I went to talk to my coach at school about it. And actually, at this point, I wasn't fully decided yet. I went to talk to my coach at school about it. And I thought, if they give me a key position, I'll stay with this team because I want to win an NCAA ring. I went to talk to my coach about it, and he cut me in the meeting. So I thought, wow, that makes it easy. I don't have to play college anymore. I'll go play pro. Yeah, so that was in February, I guess. March, I got sent or went home from school and was stuck there until a few weeks ago because of COVID. But now I'm finally here, and in 6 days, on November 20th, I'll be moving to Timor-Leste to start playing soccer.
Isn't that amazing? So this the way God does something, and it takes time, and it takes patience, and it takes letting something potentially die, right? A desire, a will, a purpose, a calling, whatever it might be. It's just, hey, put it on the altar of the Lord and see what God does with it. And in this case, right, God took it all around, and now he's playing professional soccer on an island close by. Right? Isn't that awesome? And he's getting paid for it. All right. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
God bless you.
Amen. It's always encouraging to see how God works in other people's life. And sometimes when you're waiting for God to work in your life and nothing happened, right? But when you see other people, when God's working in other people's life, it encourages you to know that God is still, you know,
still working.
He's still working. Maybe not for you at the moment. Maybe it takes time for you, but you know, but God is still working for all of us. Amen. There's power in the blood.
Would you be free from the burden of sin? There's power in the blood. Power in the blood. Would your evil victory win? There is wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonderful power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonderful power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Would you be free from your passion and pride? There's power in the blood. Power in the blood. For a cleansing to Calvary's side. There's a wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood.
In the blood
of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Would you be wider, much wider than snow? There's power in the blood, power in the blood.
Sin stains are lost in its life-giving flow.
There's a wonderful power in the blood.
There's power.
There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood.
In the blood
of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb.
Would you do service?
Would you do service for Jesus, your King? There's power in the
power,
power in the blood. Would you lift daily his praises to sing? There is wonderful power in the blood.
There's power.
There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood.
In the blood
of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood.
There's power.
There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood.
In the blood of the Lamb.
There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood.
In the precious blood.
In the precious blood.
In the precious blood.
In the precious blood of the Lamb.
Today's reading from the book of John, chapter 8, verse 31 to 36. To the Jews who had believed him, Jesus said, "If you hold to me, to my teaching, you are really my disciples. Then you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free." They answered him, "We are Abraham's descendants and have never been slaves of anyone. How can you say that we shall be set free?" Jesus replied, "Very truly I tell you, anyone who sins is a slave to sin. Now a slave has no permanent place in the family, but a son belongs to it forever. So if the Son sets you free, you will be free indeed."
Welcome, everyone. Nice to see you. Thank you for joining us. Thank you for being live here in the audience and online. So good to see everybody. I'm not going to mention names. I'm not going to make that mistake again, because that, just in case there are privacy concerns. But thank you for Asanka reading scripture, Cliff joining us in song and worship with Jane and Chris. We've been starting this new series called Tipping the Scale. And in this series, last week we looked at how love, the royal law of love that James describes, tips the scale from anger, from resentment, from bitterness, that love tips the scale in all situations and all things. Our heart consumed with the love of God tips the scale for the grace and love of God to be shown to our brothers and sisters in Christ. You know, we talked about the Good Samaritan and how the Good Samaritan, helped this person in need. The royal law of love is to love others as you love yourself, he says. And the Good Samaritan, he helped. Who did he help? The guy in need. The guy along his path, in his journey, in his sphere of influence at the moment. Did he go out and just say, hey, I'm going to go start a hospital to save everybody? No, he didn't. Although there's many hospitals named Good Samaritan, right? Starting orphanages and schools and hospitals, these are awesome and amazing things, but not most of us do those things. Most of us are just simply in the path, and we look to the one in need that comes up in our day. Sorry for my microphone problem. So today we're looking at this other one. It's called the Law of Liberty. And this is also found in James. You know, the U.S. Constitution, there's two primary goals of it. This is the law of America. Two primary goals. One, it's to form a more perfect union, it says. What we have now, the writers of the Constitution said, let's get this to form a better union, a more perfect union. So it was something to help us be better, to be more united, to be more perfect, to see the goal and work towards that goal. The second thing was to secure the blessings of liberty for everyone. It was to enshrine that everyone enjoys the blessings of freedom. Freedom is a fundamental idea based in the Constitution of America. So one day, a preschool teacher was telling her children, they said, one of the great things about our country is that we are all free. And the little boy raised his hand and said, ma'am, I'm not free, I'm four. So he was right, they're not all free. But today, we're going to be looking into freedom and what this brings. And if we're going to start in James chapter 1, verse 25. Okay, Nani, can you get it? You get it now? Okay. They'll be going, what? I don't get it. I get it. It's a language thing. I get it. So James chapter 1, James, he's writing about trials and temptations and going through these things. And then he gets to this part about being a listener and being a good listener, and not just a listener, but a doer of what we listen to. And he says in verse 19, he says, my dear brothers and sisters, take note of this. Everyone be quick to listen and slow to speak and slow to become angry, because human anger does not produce the righteousness that God desires. Therefore, get rid of all moral filth and evil that is so prevalent, and humbly accept the word planted in you, which can save you. Humbly submit to the word which is planted in you. It means you've been listening to the word of God. You've been hearing it. Now, don't just hear it, but let it do something, and take it and do something with it, because this word is the word that can save you. It can save you in your circumstances. It can save you in your trouble. It can save you in your life, physically, mentally, spiritually. He says, do not merely listen to the word and so deceive yourselves. Say, well, I listened to it. That's good enough. But do what it says. Anyone who listens to the word but does not look, but does not do it, is like someone who looks at their face in the mirror and then looks away and forgets what they saw. Right? You ever go into a room and you go into the kitchen or whatever it might be, and you walk in and you go, why am I here? What was I getting? What was that? I don't remember. What was it? Anyone do that? Yeah, of course, right? You ever listen to somebody and, you know, they're talking, you're listening, or you think you're listening, and then you ask a question and they're like, I just said that. Yeah, right. My wife laughs, right? This is the nature of our relationship. It's true, yeah. So did you, I just told you that. Weren't you listening? Yeah, that's how it goes in our home. But here he says, then he says this in verse 25. He says, but the one who looks into the perfect law. It's not just a casual glance in the mirror, but the one who looks into it. This word look is to stoop down and really peer into it. The one who looks into the perfect law of liberty. We had the royal law of love, and now he's saying the perfect law of liberty, and continues in it, and not being a forgetful hearer, but doing what he's heard. This is the one who is blessed in what he does. Right? So the one that looks deeply into the perfect law of liberty. This word perfect, it's the same word that form of the word that Jesus said on the cross when he said, it is finished. Right? It is complete. There's a goal that I'm working towards, and we've completed it. And we use that word as the same base word here, and it's this perfect law of freedom. And this, I mean, in other words, your freedom, the goal of you being free, I've done it. It's completed. I've done it for you. And this is where we're going to look in today. You know, we go back to Genesis chapter 1. You always go back to the beginning. And Genesis is just an amazing, amazing book. It really sets the premise. But back here in Genesis chapter 1, we see that God created and it was good. In fact, it was very good. And then God created man, and that was very good too. But he said to the man, he said this, he says, God blessed them and said to them, be fruitful and multiply, right? Be fruitful and multiply. This isn't just go have a lot of babies, right? This is what we then be fruitful, oh yeah, just go ahead, right? But it is God created this perfect world, this perfect universe, this perfect garden. And inside that garden is all the potential that we need to live and to be fruitful and to multiply. And God created man. He said, you can have everything in the garden to eat. Everything is yours. Enjoy it all. In fact, he said, he put Adam in the garden so that he could work the garden and he could tend to it and he could care for it. And this is the joy and freedom we have. And then, in fact, God said he brought all the animals to Adam and said, you name them. Name them whatever you want. Just whatever you name them, that's the name of them. I mean, what kind of freedom is that? Where God in his creation looks to mankind and says, you have the freedom to live, to enjoy, to create, to multiply, to increase, and to use all the potential I've given to you. And just go enjoy it and use it. Wow, what freedom. Right? Lion. Turtle. Hippopotamus. Oh, sorry, I didn't mean. Oh, sorry. That's how the hippopotamus got a name. He coughed when he said it. See, you didn't get that. I'm sorry. So all this freedom that God had when he created, and mankind was given freedom. This was our original design. This is our original blueprint, that we have freedom in Christ. We have freedom in the world. He didn't say, Lord, what is your will for the name of this animal that you have provided and brought it to me? But he had the freedom to enjoy and to name, to partake, to participate in God's world. And then, of course, in chapter 3, we get to this point where Adam and Eve, and God said to them, he said, look, you can have every tree of the garden. I mean, that's a lot of freedom. But there's this one tree, just one. I just have one rule. He says, you have a world of freedom, but I've just got one rule. Don't touch the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. That tree, don't touch it. Don't eat of that one. That one's off limits. If you do, you'll die. That's not good. Stay away. All the freedom in the world, and you can enjoy and run around, and it says that they were naked and they weren't ashamed. I mean, they had so much freedom. They had. And why is this in there? Why is that little line in there? Because they're conscious. Their consciousness was free, free from guilt, free from fear, free from shame, free from worries and things that fill our minds that we get trapped in. They were free from that in their conscience. And it was beautiful until, right? Don't eat. I got one rule. Don't eat of that tree. So it's like in my house. I've got one rule. Said so you can eat anything you want in the refrigerator. Anything. You can have it all. But don't eat my cake. That's it. One rule. Don't eat my cake. You can have anything you want. Enjoy the fruits and vegetables and enjoy the all that stuff. Don't touch my cake. And what do? They take this freedom and they disobey God. And the whole system comes crashing down, right? Sin enters the world. Death enters the world. Spiritual death, physical death. This whole snowball effect. God curses the ground and he curses all these things. And the whole system just goes to pot. And our freedom is gone, right? Because, you know, this freedom that we have in our potential and everything that God gives us, this freedom, but it also comes responsibility. But with sin comes restrictions and we become enslaved. In Exodus, we see that, you know, it snowballs to the effect that God's people they're in Egypt and they are slaves. They're slaves to the Egyptians. And from that point, what does God do? He sets them free. And God always sets this reminder and he says, remember when I set you free. Remember when you were slaves and you were under someone else's oppressive rule and I set you free. And he always wanted them to look back to that. And the Passover was that meal, that moment, that time when they had looked back to that. Could you imagine back in May of 1945 when in World War II, when all these people were in concentration camps? And that day when they were set free, they were under these oppressive rulers. They lost their freedom. And that moment, that day when they were set free, wow, I couldn't even imagine what they would feel. Freedom. Because this is the problem. When sin entered the world, this problem of it has enslaved us. It has held us captive. But Psalm 119, verse 45, and my wife gave me this. She said, you got to put this in the message. This one's good. So here it is. It says, the psalmist says, I walk in freedom. For I have devoted myself to your commandments. I walk in freedom, but I'm devoted to your commandments. I'm devoted. There's still responsibility to be obedient to you, to serve you. Right? But as the world goes on, we certainly see that sin has taken its toll. But then Isaiah, the prophet in 61:6 says this thing. He says, the spirit of the sovereign Lord is on me. Because the Lord has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim freedom to the captives, and to release from darkness for the prisoners. And Jesus, hundreds of years later, he's in a synagogue and he takes the scroll of Isaiah and he stands up and he reads this very passage. And he says, he puts it away and he says, this verse has been fulfilled before your very eyes. I have come to bring freedom. Sin has bound us. It has enslaved us. I have come to bring freedom. You know, Mark, the Gospel of Mark, he writes about this story. In Mark chapter 4, he starts off by saying that Jesus, after he did all this teaching, he said, Jesus then said, hey guys, let's get in a boat and cross the lake over there. Oh, okay, Jesus, let's get in, let's go. And off they go. And on the journey, a storm comes. And this storm comes and it shakes everything. It's so big that these fishermen who live on the water, basically, were so afraid that they said, Jesus, save us. We're going to die. Don't you care? We're going to drown. And Jesus, in 4:39, he stands up and he says, be still. And he says, why are you so afraid? And they look at him and they're like, oh my, who is this? Who is this that even the wind and waves obey him? Jesus comes on the scene and he has authority. Authority. And what the disciples are seeing is that he has authority over the natural world. Who has that kind of authority? Who has that kind of power that the wind and the waves obey his voice? That's quite the authority. Why are we afraid of the coronavirus? I'm not saying don't be cautious. I'm not saying, but the fear of it. When God has authority over the natural world, why are we afraid of the unknown? When God has authority over the natural world, why are we afraid of elections or presidents or governments? When God says he has authority over all things, and no one has authority unless God gives it to them. This is what Jesus said to Pilate before he was crucified. From there, they get off the boat and they're on the other side. They're not in Jewish territory anymore. They're in Gentile land. And Jesus brings them here for this very moment. And now they're outside of their culture. They're outside of their world. They're in a new place. These people don't believe in our God. And not only that, but they're close to a cemetery. They're close to death. And then this demon-possessed man comes running out of the cemetery. And they got pigs running around everywhere. They're like, man, to a Jew, this place is off limits, right? There's pigs, there's death, there's Gentiles. What did you bring us here for? You brought us into the very place of darkness and death. And this demon-possessed man, who said, the Bible says in Mark that he's been chained and he breaks through the chains. No one can hold him down. He's powerful and he screeches and he yells and he does all these things. He howls like an animal. And he comes running to Jesus and he bows down before him. And the demons speak out of him and they say, please, please, what do you want with us? Don't terrorize us. In other words, the one that has authority. Don't send us to torment. Hey, you see these pigs over there? Send us over there. Jesus gave them, the Bible says, permission to go. Because the one who has authority is the one you need to ask permission from. And even the supernatural world needs to ask permission from the one who has all authority. To act, to move, to do. But the evil spirits, they are there and they are there to destroy. They are there to torment. They are there to take anything away from the Lord. But you see, Jesus, he did. He let them go into the pigs and the pigs, they all went wild. And they just lost their minds and they all ran off the cliff and about 2,000 pigs died. They ran into the water and drowned. Interesting, isn't it? And The man comes, and the man who had all these demons released out of him, he's dressed and he's sitting and he's in his right mind before the Lord. And the people came and they saw, they were amazed and they were afraid and they were scared. And they're like, what did you do to my pigs? That's my livelihood, right? Get out of here. You're scaring us. But this man who had this, he was enslaved. He was enslaved by the supernatural world. He had no power over himself. There was illegitimate authority over his life by the supernatural world. And Jesus set him free. And he said, Lord, can I follow you? Can I get back in the boat and follow you? Can I be your disciple? He's like, no, you can't. What I want you to do is go back to all these cities, this whole area, and tell them what the Lord has done for you. Wow, that's another sermon for another day. Don't follow me, go tell. Interesting. But at this point, they get back in the boat. They go back to the other side. I mean, Jesus did that for them. He saw this whole boat trip. What did they see? That Jesus has authority over the natural world. He has authority over the supernatural world, the spiritual world. And then they get back in the boat. And as soon as they land on the other side, another guy comes running up and says, Jesus, my daughter is dying. Please come and heal her. And as he's on his way, this woman who has been sick for 12 years, who has done everything, spent all her money on doctors and help, and she only got worse. And she goes and she says, if I could just touch his clothes, just the edge of his garment, if I could just touch it, I'll be healed. And she does. And she is. And he says to her, he says, you are freed from all your suffering. Be free from your suffering. And they sat back and they saw, and of course he goes on to, and the guy's daughter dies. He heals her, it raises her from the dead. And you see, Jesus has authority over our personal physical world, over your life, over your physical life, over your health, over everything happening in our personal world. Jesus has authority over all. But which authority do we submit to? He has authority to set people free from their mental slavery. He has authority to set people free from their spiritual slavery. He has authority to set people free from their physical slavery. In John 8, 34 and 36, as Asanka has read, Jesus said, verily, very truly, I tell you, everyone who sins is a slave to sin. Now, a slave has no permanent place in a family. They're just a servant, a slave to the family. But a son belongs to it forever. And if the son sets you free, you will be free indeed. Right? The son says to the slave, you are free, then you are free. You enjoy all the rights and privileges of freedom. Paul says in Acts 13, 38 through 39, he says, therefore, my friends, I want you to know that through Jesus, the forgiveness of sins is proclaimed to you. What is our greatest entrapment? Our sin. Our shortcomings, our failures, our bad habits, the things that the things that are going around in our heart that we don't let anyone know, but we still feel enslaved to them. He says, your sins are forgiven. They're proclaimed to you through him. Everyone who believes is set free from every sin. Everyone who believes in Christ is set free from sin. The blood gives us this forgiveness that sets us free from every sin. There was a writer named Margarita Lasky, and she's was born in England, but she's Jewish. She's an atheist. And she said, what I envy most about you Christians is your forgiveness. I have no one to forgive me. And this is the world that people are lost in. They're entrapped. They want forgiveness. They know they need forgiveness, but there's no one to forgive them. Ultimately, You can say, I forgive you, but it's still there. Only God, Jesus, can do that. Paul then goes into this whole kind of theology and understanding of this in Romans 5 and 6 and 7. And it's beautiful. I don't have time to read it all, but he goes into this whole idea that Jesus Christ, when he died, that everyone who believes in him died with him. And if we died with him, then we are raised with him to life. And he goes on, and if you have your Bibles, you just look at Romans 5, and it's just awesome. I encourage you to read it this week. Therefore, just as sin entered the world through one man, he says, right, Adam? Remember Adam? Sin entered the world through him. That's why we call it the Adamic nature that we have, right? Because it's this sin nature that we've inherited and we have and that exists in all of us. But sin entered the world through one man in verse 12. And he says, but in death through sin. And in this way, death came to all people, all of us. To be sure, sin was in the world before, and he goes on talking about before Moses and the law. He says, but the gift, and I love this in verse, if I can see it without glasses, 15. It says, but the gift is not like the trespass. It's the gift from God is not like the sin that has happened. For if the many died by the trespass of the one man, how much more did God's grace and the gift that came by the grace of the one man, Jesus Christ, overflow to many? He says, look, this gift that you have of salvation in Christ, how much more does that take care of all the trespass? If death came through one man, how much more does life come through Jesus Christ? Nor can the gift be compared with the result of one man's sin. He says, then he goes down to verse 17. For if by the trespass of one man, death reigned through that one man, how much more will those who receive God's abundant provision of grace and the gift of righteousness reign in the life through one man, Jesus Christ? And he goes through this whole thing of six. And he says that the old self in chapter six was crucified with him. And the body that was ruled by sin, it might be done away with. Our old sinful heart and nature, it's crucified with Christ. And we should no longer be slaves to sin. Because if we're dead, if the body's dead, then sin is dead. But if we are raised with Christ, then we are alive with him. And so we have a brand new nature in Jesus Christ because we have died. Our sin has died. Our old man, our old nature died with him. And we have a new nature alive with him through the resurrection. This is what Paul says in Galatians 2:20. This is a verse we should all memorize. I have been crucified with Christ and it's no longer, and I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. The life that I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. This, in essence, is the gospel. This is where I have exchanged my old life, and in return, I got the life of Christ. And with that life comes freedom, because sin and the mastery of sin has died. Who died on the cross? Jesus. Who died with him? Everyone who has accepted what he has done for us. If I choose to accept what he did for me, sin no longer has illegitimate authority over me. Now God has true authority. And what do we do? What is this Jesus is saying is that we have now we're coming back around again. And he restores the original human design of who we are from the garden. Before the fall, because he was told to rule, and now we are told to reign in Jesus Christ. We are said we can reign through him. So this means that this character flaw that I have, it does not define who I am. This sin, this bad habit I have, it doesn't define who I am. The addiction that I might struggle with, it doesn't define who I am, because sin, my old nature, has been crucified. I am now in Christ. And there's going to be questions about that. We're going to talk about that next week. But the Holy Spirit empowers you and I to make right decisions through this new life. So then back in James, what does it mean that we focus on this perfect law of liberty? And in James 2:12, he says, "Now speak and act as those who are going to be judged by the law that gives freedom." He's saying, first, don't you understand that this law of liberty is basically the gospel message? That Christ, that our sin has been crucified, we are alive unto God, we are new in him. We have a new nature. And everything that we speak and see should result from this very act, my new identity in Christ. So when I sin, what do I do? Do I wallow in my guilt? Do I wallow in my shame? This is what Adam and Eve did. They got leaves and tried to cover up. God said, "Well, what are you doing? We're naked." Well, who told you that? Our conscience now, it's plaguing us. We know the guilt. We know that this disobedience. We know this thing. It enslaves us. But Jesus has come full circle to set us free, to set our conscience free. The first thing he sets us free from is our sin. The second thing he sets us free from is condemnation. Romans 8:1, he says, there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. He says, if your conscience condemns you, the one who is greater than your conscience doesn't. This is beautiful. This is beautiful, this cycle that God has taken from the very beginning. And he's redeemed humanity, and he's redeemed us through his blood, through his sacrifice, so that we now can live in the original design of how God, to be free, to rule, to reign, to be fruitful and multiply, to not be weighted down by a guilty conscience, but to live in freedom that God has made us free. He said, "You are no longer a slave to sin. I have broken those chains. You are free." That's beautiful. So the next time that we fail, what Paul is teaching us here is to look at the law of freedom that Jesus Christ has set you free. Say, the blood of Christ, I'm forgiven. I am forgiven. I am forgiven. That is no longer I, because I is dead. That old I is dead. I have a new identity, a new nature. And this is thing we have to look at ourselves, right? It says, look intently at this perfect law of liberty. Don't just pass it by. And I think many of us just pass the gospel by and say, yeah, I'm saved. I'm gonna go on. But there's so much more into it. It's a daily experience of knowing my identity is in Christ. I'm brand new. The old is passed away. It's been crucified. So I don't live in this condemnation. I don't live in guilt. I don't live in shame. I shouldn't, if I'm looking intently to the perfect law of liberty. And that's beautiful for us. That gives us the strength to go on today. That gives us the hope for the future. That gives us to be able to live in joy for today, in a new relationship with God today, and in the freshness of the life that God gives to us. In Jesus' name, amen. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for this law of liberty that you have made completed. You've completed it with your work on the cross. You said it's finished, that our old man is dead. It's crucified. It's buried with you. Life has come. We are brand new in you if we choose to believe in you. If we believe that what you did is for me. And I'm not just a hearer of it, but I'm a doer. I believe it. I take it in. I practice it in my life when I fail. I practice it in my life when I show love towards others. Lord, thank you for setting us free. If there's anyone that does not know Jesus, then you're still chained to your sin. You feel enslaved to it. You've never accepted Christ. You don't have this new life. Simply put your faith in him. Give your heart to him. Say, Jesus, forgive me of my sin. Forgive me. Come into my life and change me. Be my Lord. I'm choosing you. When you give your heart to Jesus, he sets you free and he gives you this new identity in him. We thank you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you, everyone. God bless you. Here's Chris.
I'd like to invite all of us to stand up as we close this song, Wonderful, Merciful Savior.
Counselor, Comforter, Keeper, Spirit.
told.